सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। We are here at this webinar 198 to go into this question of intelligence. Intelligence is a word which means many things to many people. In this webinar, however, we are going to look at this word intelligence on such a deep plane. On one hand, it's difficult to really define what it is, where it is. On the other, it is at the same time so obvious that there is something called intelligence which can make or mar one's life. People with intelligence may rise to any height. Being born poor, with intelligence they may become very rich. Being born with no power at all, they could become emperors, and that again through hard work and lot of right choices. Around the world, even today, we find stories of people who go from rags to riches. And this rise doesn't have to be on the scale of wealth alone. People who did not have even two square meals a day, somehow taking help from X or Y, A or B, make it to a college, then make it to post-graduation, then they head laboratories or other institutions which are of world class. And when you see their life, how it all began, you wonder how they could make their way to such top positions of excellence. In contrast, there are people who are born with lot of advantages, who are born with a silver spoon in their mouth, as the expression I guess goes, who have so much of support, encouragement from their family, from their relatives and whatnot, and yet because of unintelligent choices that they made. We find stories of that kind also. Riches to rags. From being very coveted or in a coveted position, they become pitiable. The whole world is so sad to see the degradation in their status, in their position, and so on. Therefore, we are going to see how Vidura, in this famous portion of Mahabharata, calls intelligence as the greatest bala, that is, balam, strength. Let me at this point open. A few slides. I notice there is a bit of chat message. That is okay, there's nothing special. So I try to, yes, here we are. I have put down a few points to share with you, and I'm going straight away to the last slide of a slideshow. I will come back to the earlier slides after making a few comments based on this last slide. Intelligence versus lack of it. You know, in the Mahabharata itself, in spite of such wise counsel that Vidura gave him, Dhritarashtra, lacking intelligence, lost everything. And he caused so much of misery to both sides, Kauravas and Pandavas. And we find in the Valmiki Ramayana, Vishwamitra, trusting mere physical power, or as the third bullet says, muscles and missiles, dares challenge Vasishta. And in that very interesting story, Vishwamitra, with a huge army, gets defeated by Vasishta. And a line in the Valmiki Ramayana is much quoted, giving us a contrast between gross power or gross strength and subtle strength, which is implied by intelligence. The statement is, where Vishwamitra finally gets so frustrated and declares, Dik balam kshatriya balam, balam tejo balam, brahma tejo balam balam. Brahma tejas, spiritual radiance. Vasishta, with a tremendous amount of tapas, living in an austere way, not mere bookish scholarship, not mere scholarship enabling anybody to speak or write, but 24/7, Vasishta had been living in an austere way. We may connect this intelligence with alertness, with watchfulness, with an awakened and very vigilant conscience. And it's not just the conscience saying something, there is intelligence in the lady or the man to understand the voice of conscience in the right perspective. If you don't have intelligence, even if we have a conscience saying something, do this, don't do that, we just put down the conscience. We say to the conscience, shut up now, don't disturb me. I am going ahead and doing whatever I want to do. Therefore, Vasishta, who had lived in harmony with his conscience, with his education, with whatever spiritual learning he had received from his teachers, had risen to certain spiritual balam, that is called Brahma Tejo Balam. And Vishwamitra, the king of the country, confesses that my Kshatriya Balam, which is representative of anything grosser, is of no use. Dhik, I don't want this. Muscles and missiles are no comparison to precise understanding of our life, our situations, our relationships, and so on. And spiritual power, spiritual wisdom shines through that kind of precise understanding. I give credit to Mr. Srinivasan Nadipuram. He is a gentleman in Nashville, Tennessee, who every day gives out wonderful messages on Hindu scriptures. And when he got the invitation on this Vidura Niti webinar, he wrote several comments from his side before sharing that invitation with his circle of friends. And among the comments he made a comparison between Vidura Niti's power of intelligence and Valmiki Ramayana's Brahma Tejo Balam, Brahma Tejas. In a dramatic turn of events, those of you who have read the Valmiki Ramayana version of that story know, Vasishta holds his Brahma Danda up holds it up in the air, and so many weapons that Vishwamitra throws at Vasishtha get absorbed in that Brahmadanda, unable to harm him in any way. So without intelligence, we would be Dhritarashtra. With a huge kingdom that he is ruling, he could not decide properly and caused so much ruin. Without intelligence, we would be Vishwamitra. Without intelligence, we would be the main person of so many stories where they went from bad to worse, from worse to even worse, and then died a miserable death. With intelligence, as this slide shows, you and I, no matter in what field we are, maybe in management, maybe in scientific research, maybe in running a house, maybe in business, maybe as scholars working in some subject, doesn't matter. In whatever field we are, we will be able to realize our hidden high potential. And sometimes it is intelligence which even enables us to change our field, go to an entirely new domain. We can accomplish magical results. We can discern between true and false. And what is so important in life, it is intelligence that helps us take right decisions, which then enable us to solve problems. And using the religious language of Hinduism, when you and I find that our past karma is pulling us down, it is intelligence again with which we can even burn the results of past karmas. Much can be said about the glory of intelligence. Now I come to the first slide, then let us go a little slowly, not too slowly. We have more wisdom from Vidura Niti, and for those of you who have not attended my earlier webinar on Vidura Niti, I must quickly, within a minute I hope, say that Vidura Niti appears in the fifth canto called Udyoga Parva, which is also called Prajagara Parva, and in that Udyoga Parva of Mahabharata, it is chapters 33 to 40. In other words, 8 chapters in Udyoga Parva are Vidura Niti. Vidura advises Dhritarashtra, and at many places, in no uncertain terms, without mincing words, he says to Dhritarashtra, just give half kingdom to Pandavas, keep half with your sons and yourself, and let Pandavas and Kauravas learn to complement each other. At several places, he says, if your sons Kauravas are the forest, Pandavas are the lions which protect the forest. Lions need the forest kind of environment for them to feel safe, and forest needs lions to protect their trees from anybody who might come and cut them. So it is called Vana Simha Nyaya. Vidura uses that expression, he is saying Vana and Vyagra at some verses, Vana and Simha at one or two verses. Either way, he says, Pandavas and Kauravas should actually help each other. What's this going on? You are the person who should stop it. But lack of intelligence makes Dhritarashtra hear everything with one ear and leave it with the other, leading to so much of catastrophe. So Vidura Niti in 8 chapters comes to 592 verses. The entire Mahabharata is 100,000, that is, in India we call it 1 lakh verses. So what are the 5 kinds of strength that Vidura says to Dhritarashtra or informs Dhritarashtra? Balam panchavidham nityam purushanam nibodhame yattu bahubalam nama kanishtam balam uchyate. In our utter immaturity, we attach too much value to physical strength. Know from me the five kinds of strength found always with people. The different people have different strength. The second line is not translated here. That means yattu bahubalam, physical strength, that is the lowest among the five. Kanishtam balam uchyate, physical strength is of less importance, and in these days it has become even less than in olden times. With tremendous explosion of knowledge, of information technology, of knowledge management, knowledge workers, and unbelievable advances of science and technology, if somebody just is physically strong, or on another level, somebody just has weapons and missiles and, you know, those things, if he doesn't know who is his enemy and who is his friend, I guess his strength and his weapons will destroy him rather than help him. So Vidura says, Bahubalam Kanishtam Balam. But take a quick look at the five kinds of bala. In four verses, we are going to see these five balas. Bahubalam, physical strength. Amatya Labaha. If you and I have good advisors, a king has, let us say, a wise minister. Dhritarashtra had, but you see, because of lack of intelligence, nothing was of use. Having good advisors is the second kind of bala. Dhana labha. Most people think if they have a lot of money, there will be no problem whatsoever. That is so foolish. Money has a place, but those who have no intelligence will mess up their wealth also. They will lose it also. As we shall see, a verse later will say that if you have intelligence, you can get other four kinds of bala. Whereas if you don't have intelligence, you will lose the four kinds of bala, strength, which you might have had somehow. What you had, you will lose in lack of intelligence. In the presence of true intelligence, you will be able to gather what you did not have in the beginning. Abhijata balam, inborn talent. You and I, whether we like it or not, have, after all, something that modern science would say we have received genetically. They say it's in his gene. Oh, that is in her gene. Some kind of talent, some kind of gift, some kind of even appearance. We will see some details of it later. So inborn. Some people have some inborn talents and gifts. That is abhijata balam. And last is this main topic, intelligence. To make it even clearer, I have added an adjective, enhanced intelligence. Because some intelligence everyone has. Those who have enhanced intelligence, that is in Sanskrit called prajnabalam. Somewhere else it could be called dhi. Dhi is also intelligence. Buddhi is intelligence. And jnanam could also be the word. But in these four verses which we are presently seeing in Viduraniti, the wise cousin of Dhritarashtra. As you know, Dhritarashtra was Ambika's son, father was Vyasa, and Pandu was Ambalika's son, again Vyasa was the father, and Vidura was the son of a servant maid of Ambika and Ambalika. Father was again Vyasa. So their mothers are different. The father is Vyasa. And the king of the country was Vichitravirya. So you will find in the Vidura Niti, at places, Vidura addressing Dhritarashtra, Vichitravirya, O son of Vichitravirya. For as you know, Vyasa came and he with his tapashakti made these three ladies conceive and deliver babies. Otherwise, these two ladies surely were wives of Vichitravirya, who had died and gone away. That's how Vyasa had been called to help. So we have many words for intelligence. Prajnabalam is what Vidura uses. Now let's take, for we said a couple of things about the Bhavabalam, the physical strength, second, and Dhanalabha. Amatya labham bhadram te dvitiyam balam uchyate tritiyam dhanalabham tu balam ahur manishinah. Manishinah, wise people call wealth as the third kind of strength. Financial muscle, that is a word used sometimes. Amatya literally means minister. These days you and I don't have ministers, but we may have people who advise us, people who give us a bit of a piece of their mind. And if we have excellent advisors, that is indeed a great advantage. It's such great merit. Leaders who have mere sycophants, people who simply praise them, leaders who have so-called advisors who actually just say to the king or the leader, oh, you are right, you could never go wrong. Oh, what a wonderful decision you took, etc. Just to make him happy. Priyavadinaha. Another place in Vidura Niti, Vidura talks about this issue. How in this world it's easy to get people who praise you, but very difficult to get a friend or an advisor who calls a spade, who says to you, this is wrong, don't do this. And at places, very frankly says, this is the right thing to do. Even if it costs a lot, go ahead and do it. So, satyavadinaha viralaha priyavadinaha bahavasanti. There is going to be a shloka at another place. Therefore, think of the three strengths, bahubalam, amatyabalam, and then dhanabalam, called here dhanalabha. So we admit all these have some strength. There are times when all you need is money. Now, in this pandemic scenario, in many places in the world, and all the more in India, oxygen balam, there is dearth of oxygen. Yesterday, 20 people died in New Delhi because the hospital was intimated by the authorities that by 5:30 p.m. we are sending oxygen at high pressure for to cleanse and to resuscitate the lungs of some patients. Just oxygen cylinders were not enough. Certain oxygen at high pressure was required, as the newspaper says. But 5:30, 6:30, 7 p.m., nothing came. Then with the ordinary cylinders of oxygen which the hospital had, they were trying to bring energy to those patients, but it did not have the desirable effect. 20 people died because no oxygen came to that hospital well in time. So you can talk of oxygen balam. At such places, you want to be able to speak. Oratorical balam. Balam is of hundreds of kinds, many, many ways, but broadly, Vidura speaks of five kinds of bala. One strength is bahubala, physical strength. Second is amatyalabha, good advisors. Third is dhanalabha. And now we have the fourth, for which he gives a whole shloka. The third among the four is this shloka, the fourth kind of strength, this which needs a little pondering. What actually is this inborn talent? He says, yattu asya sahajam rajan. For any person, asya purushasya kasyapi. Rajan, O king, O dhritarashtra, pitra paitamaham balam. Maybe he has got it from his father or mother. Maybe he has got it, she or he has got it from grandfather, grandmother, and so on. Don't we say sometimes when we find somebody performing very well, we say, oh, I knew her grandmother. She was also like that. Same trait has come in this granddaughter. And we give credit to the grandmother. So it comes in our gene, or it is hereditary. And since it is in us from childhood, that is abhijata balam. Sometimes you find a family in olden days, you know, 10 children, 12 children, and everybody is into materialistic things. And one of the 10, maybe a daughter, is spiritual. Somehow she is so drawn to spiritual activities. And then typically elders say, this child alone has gone for spirituality. This is that particular grandmother. So they connect it to one of the ancestors. Whatever it is, the abhijata. Abhijata means at the time of birth itself, you received a gift. So it could be talent, it could be temperament, it could be disposition, it could be even facial expressions, the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you stand, the way you sit, when you get angry, when you hold back, when you over-talk, when you, you know, talk less, various habits. And many times we say it runs in their family. I don't want to mention names. There was one family in Mysore. I observed that a brother was talking continuously, you know, so talkative. And on the fourth day of my visit, I saw his sister also very talkative. Then I told somebody, how come this brother and sister very talkative? They said, Swamiji, you have met only two. All the children in that family are talkative. And what do you do? Therefore, abhijata balam, please understand, could be any facet. And if it is favorable, then we call it balam. If it is unfavorable, obviously, we would call it daurbalyam. That's a weakness in their family. You know, there was one family who were all obese. All of them having much more weight than was desirable. So somebody asked, does obesity run in their family? And the other guy was witty. He said, no, obesity doesn't run in their family. Problem is nobody runs in their family. Therefore, nobody runs in their family. Therefore, all of them are obese. So, abhijata balam, that is chaturtham balam smritam. All of us know, every one of us has our own strengths. Sometimes when somebody compliments us for some good quality, certain talent, we are embarrassed. And then don't we all do it quietly in our own heart? We thank maybe our mother, maybe a certain uncle, some connection. Oh, I got it genetically from those people. Sometimes karma siddhanta says it is your purva karma. No contradiction between the two. Because of your purva karma, you are born as the nephew of that famous writer, and therefore you also are a good writer. So purva karma and being born as nephew of a gifted writer come together. Therefore, there is no contradiction. There is no need to ask, tell us one of the two. Is it because of past karma or is it because he is born as the nephew of that uncle? We say both of them together are the reason. It's like somebody who has studied engineering is working in an engineering company. Now, would you say he is doing engineering work because he is in an engineering company, and he is doing engineering work because he went to an engineering college? Now, these come together. Being in an engineering company in the technical division and having an engineering qualification are what describe the whole scenario. Your purva karma, your being born as the nephew of this person who has certain talents, are one issue or one cause that is expressed in two ways. With this, we will go to the best of all, prajna balam, the best of all, the strength called intelligence. The shloka, the fourth among the four I have selected, this fifth chapter among those eight has 64 shlokas, as many as there are squares on a chessboard. And 52 to 55 among them are what we are seeing in this webinar. Yena tu etani sarvani sangrahitani bharata yad balanam balam shreshtam tat prajna balam uchyate. If we have enhanced intelligence, prajna balam, then you have all the five and it is the best. Balanam balam. R. W. Emerson, the famous poet and writer of America, said this about intelligence: a cheerful, intelligent face is the end of culture. Not wealth, not position, not awards, not degrees, not popularity, but a cheerful, intelligent face, truly intelligent face, not deceptively, truly cheerful. A cheerful, intelligent face is the end of culture and success enough. You don't need any other success. How nicely Emerson put it. For it indicates the purpose of nature. I regard that also as a wonderful observation. Nature is working on every one of us, not towards more wealth or more power or more name or more fame. They are all secondary for nature. Nature is working upon us, teaching us lessons, helping us learn, helping us find out where we went wrong, where we were right. Nature is constantly chiseling out of us. And Emerson said it rightly. For this cheerful, intelligent face indicates the purpose of nature and wisdom attained. Ralph Waldo Emerson and Vidura seem to shake hands here. Tat prajna balam uchyate. Vidura says, if you have this, all four also are as good as had. Now you may have a doubt if you think on this. Well, if you have intelligence, you may take better care of yourself and be physically strong, get stronger, understood. You may also, because of your intelligence, hire better advisors, fire poor advisors. Amatya balam you can get correct. You can also, what is that? Financial. Yeah, with intelligence you will make money. But question would be, if you have intelligence, how can you get inborn talent? Because inborn by definition is genetic, that comes with birth, that comes, you know, in the makeup of your whole brain and other things. I thought over it and it seems to me that Vidura is not wrong, but you have to interpret it slightly differently. If you have intelligence, you know what? You will be able to identify clearly where you are good at. You will be able to recognize properly your swadharma, swapratibha. You will be able to know your strengths and limitations. And because you are intelligent, you will play your cards smartly. You can't generate a abhijata bala. Abhijata bala is fixed at the time of birth. But those who are unintelligent are all the time trying to do other things where they have no talent. They ignore, they put to the back bench or they put to the back seat their inborn talent. Like my example of somebody very good writer. His uncle is and was a good writer. Now imagine this nephew, because of some fancies and some attractions and some distractions, and all of which is an expression of his lack of intelligence, doesn't write at all. Even if people ask him, please write, he says, what is there in writing? I want to become a member of parliament. I want to get into politics. He messes up his life. Therefore, even with regard to that abhijata balam, those with intelligence will be able to tap their abhijata balam. Even if it is less compared with somebody else, doesn't matter. On a scale of 10, you have 4 with regard to, let us say, writing. There may be people with 6 and 8 and 10. But that level 4 out of 10 can come handy. With your intelligence, you use it. Many a time, something that you use wisely saves you from a lot of embarrassment in life than things that you don't have at all, that you don't use at all. You must use. Use good friends. Use good resources. Use your own inborn talent. Do not shut your eyes to it. So I would say here that this prajnabalam is that which helps us increase the other 4 bala also, and in its own way, this prajnabala, intelligence. In fact, I was going through many portions of Vidura Niti. It's an amazing work. Like I said in the last session also, it's not wrong to say everything we need is in the Gita, etc. But we are not able to see sometimes the implications of a Gita shloka, though it is hidden over there. Whereas when we study something like Vidura Niti, we are able to see so clearly, my God, this is talking about us. This is talking about my sister. This is exactly how my uncle suffered. And this is how another aunt of mine rose from, you know, nowhere to great eminence. Oops, Vidura is talking human psychology so well, and so on. No wonder on ordinary levels and even on high levels of liberation, moksha, etc., the power of prajnabalam, intelligence, is mentioned by mystics. A bunch of dialogues that J. Krishnamurti had with some eminent philosophers, scientists, psychologists, etc., were put together and made into a book. In the light of his teachings only, the title was given, Awakening of Intelligence. Awakening of Intelligence is the title of a, I guess, 600-page book, where one of the dialogues is between J. Krishnamurti and Swami Venkateshananda, a great Vedantin. So all these dialogues between Krishnamurti and many eminent people of the world at that time were titled together Awakening of Intelligence. Obviously, someone like Krishnamurti too did not value Dhanabala, Bahubala, or Amatyabala, or Abhijatabala as much as he did Prajnabala, Awakening of Intelligence. Therefore, before concluding, let me tell you, in our Indian spiritual tradition, we have all the time been told, chant Gayatri.
Microphone is...
the meaning. Meditate upon its implication. And what does Gayatri Mantra mean? We meditate upon that supreme source, Savita. Some of you think Savita is Surya. That's all right. But Savita also comes from the root Su, Suyate. Sava, Prasava means giving birth. So Savita means source. Surya also is another meaning. Tat Savitur Varenyam. Bhargava, what is that? Dhiyo Yona Prachodayat, which prompts our thoughts. When we have no intelligence, All foolish thoughts are prompted from within us and do foolish things. We speak foolish things. Whereas we could have a certain intelligence waking up in us, then right thoughts, right words, right actions emanate from us. Transforming insights take place into scenarios, situations, and we are able to see great possibilities. Great possibilities, seeing of great possibilities happens. And we let go of our smallness. Lot of people with tremendous potential think of themselves as not good, not up to it. I'm not okay. I don't think I can do it, etc. Whereas it is with awakening of intelligence, then they see, as the last bullet says, we realize what we are capable of. All along, we shut our eyes to our capacity and we are envying or admiring others' capacity. Therefore, it is like the bird phoenix. Bird phoenix rises from fire with new vigor, new life. Let me, you know, for those of you who may not be very clear about this phoenix concept, I took it from the dictionary. Phoenix in classical mythology is a unique bird that lived for 5 or 6 centuries in the Arabian desert. After this time, burning itself on a funeral pyre and rising from the ashes with renewed youth to live through another cycle. So, friends, it's never too late. Whatever be your age, whatever be your station in life, you could be like the phoenix bird. Through spiritual contemplation, through yoga, through shravana and manana, your old self, which lived in fear, in insecurity, in confusion, can die. Can as though die, not really. The old self as though goes. And from the fire, from the ashes, there emerges the new self with renewed youth, with capacity, with luster, with skill, with gracefulness, and so on and so forth. All your friends would be surprised. Yeah? This is not the lady who we saw all these years. She has changed. This is a new lady now. This is a totally new brother of ours. This is a totally new uncle of ours, and so on. No matter how, as I said, old or young, we can renew ourselves with renewed youth, and that is through intelligence, not by getting a lottery prize, not getting a lot of money, not having all those other balas, amatya bala, dhana bala, bahu bala, and abhijata bala also remains unused. But if there is intelligence, dhana bala, amatya bala, abhijata bala, and bahu bala, and many other kinds of strengths, all of them come so much money. You know when to ask advice, you know when to use physical power, everything, when to do what, is thanks to prajna, intelligence. Thus, I had already covered this here. That is prajna balam, that is the strength, the best strength of all strengths, the strength that you and I should actually seek. This is how Viduraniti awakens us to what we would have missed otherwise in life. It shows, like Vedanta shows to us, what we always have been. Viduraniti awakens in us a sensitivity to certain values, certain capacities, etc., which always have been with us, but we somehow had not taken cognizance of them. Om Namah Paramarishibhyo, Paramarishibhyo Namaha. So let me see. Please feel free to ask a question or two, make comments.
Jyoti ji, you may ask.
Yes. Hari Om Swamiji. Hari Om Vipaji. Swamiji, you mentioned the past karmas burn the results of past karmas, also the intelligence.
Yeah.
How do we, can you please explain?
Yes. Actually, it may not be fully so, but let's say our past karmas are already showing their results. Now, if we were immature, lacking in intelligence, even as we are going through, let's say, the results of some bad karmas, that lack of intelligence makes us mess it up further. We react badly. We cannot take suffering in a graceful manner. We start grinding our teeth. And out of that negative reaction, we may become depressed and hundred such things. Whereas, imagine, because of some past karma, as we believe that karma phala, we might lose money, we might fall sick, some close friends may leave us, or some other damage takes place. But if there is prajna bala, intelligence, then we take a deep breath, and what has happened is not a good thing, but rather than reacting immaturely, we accept it all gracefully, and that intelligence can then help us to have an insight where something can be done about this. Suppose, you know, in lack of intelligence, take the example of sickness. I'll give this example and conclude. I am sick, having terrible stomach pain, let us say. This is because of some past karma. And a good doctor comes my way, you know, allopathy or homeopathy, Ayurveda or any other, somebody was really good. But I say, sorry, no, it's okay. And because of some complex inhibition, resistance, and lack of right mood, I reject the offer of a good homeopath, let us say. Whereas if I am intelligent, I ask him or her, how do you think you can solve my problem? And let's say it's a homeopath doctor. She explains her philosophy. We have a holistic approach. This medicine is made for such problem like you have. I have already cured 2 or 3 people. She explains to us the case history of 2 people whom she cured. My problem is similar. See, to listen to a good doctor who may come my way, you know, attentively with a balanced mind requires intelligence. Then I say, oh yeah, that impresses me. All right, please, I'll take your medicine. After examining, not unintelligently, not hastily, not just out of some mood. Then you go for that treatment, you cooperate with the doctor, you follow the do's and don'ts, and past karma appearing as that sickness is cured pretty fast. That is how intelligence can handle the results of past karma.
Thank you.
Swamiji, I have a question.
Oh yeah, please.
This is Sharda.
Sharda Devulapalli.
My question is, intelligence is good to utilize, but don't you think luck also needs to favor a person? Yes. Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi says, however hard you try, sometimes it may not work. Sometimes you may not even try anything. Your destiny plays major role than all other factors.
Yes. So just like Dhanabala, Bahubala, Amatyabala and Abhijatabala, you said one more. adrishta bala.
Yes.
It is adrishta. We don't know. We can't see why something is happening to us.
Yeah. Sometimes we try very hard, but still it doesn't work. So that means Ramana Maharishi, whatever he said, that is taking over the control of everything.
Right.
However hard you try, it may not work because that is not in your destiny.
Correct. But if you have this enhanced intelligence, even as there is bad luck in your life, you will meet with it much more gracefully than otherwise.
Yes.
Since I mentioned J. Krishnamurti's name, let me share with you. At a certain place, he said, the highest form of intelligence is to observe something without judgment. A very profound statement. So suppose because of that bad luck or because of that God's will or whatever, you know, I'm having one problem after another. Now, intelligence, according to this definition of J. Krishnamurti, would mean I look at all that misfortune without judgment, without condemning myself, without blaming myself, nor acting like a coward. So observing something without judgment neither means resisting it nor yielding to it. You see it for what it is, with a great stillness, with a great quiet alertness. Then that quiet alertness, it's easy to see, has a healing effect. Yeah. So two people, one has been very lucky. All good things are happening to him, but lacks intelligence. Amidst all those good things, that fellow will be complaining 10 times a day.
Mm.
Whereas another person, all bad things are happening to him, but if he or she has intelligence, amidst all those bad things, you will see that person coming out with a genuine smile.
Yeah. Yeah.
You ask him, how is today? And he smiles, genuine smile. Like Emerson positive. Said, cheerful.
Positive.
Yeah, sure, yeah. Sorry?
Mm.
Correct.
And he looks at positive things.
Positive, yeah.
In spite of the negative adversaries, he
correct.
Still looks at the positive.
Correct, correct. And this intelligence also, according to Ramana Maharshi and so on, because they talk from very highest level, to have such intelligence, if you or I, she or he has such intelligence, that is also God's grace.
Bhagavan says intelligence is Krishna, Bhagavan in Vibhuti.
Intelligence is Krishna, correct.
Yes. People say, I'm very intelligent, I'm smart. Out of ego, they say, most of the times we do day-to-day life, I'm a great scientist, this, that. The Bhagavan says the very intelligence you have is that is me, he says.
Yeah.
Gurudev mentioned in the United Nations video.
Oh.
You are succeeding, Bhagavan succeeding.
Mm-hmm.
You are failing, you say put the blame on Bhagavan. Gurudev explained it very well in that video.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Swami Chinmayananda's talk of the United Nations. Right.
Yes.
Yeah, person is.
Chat box, there is one question.
Okay.
By Prisha.
Okay.
Can we recite Gayatri Mantra without any Namadana from a Guru?
Can we recite, Namadana from a Guru? Oh, yeah, my view is you may, but just ensure that you recite properly, pronounce properly, and chant properly. So if you learn it from anyone, it's pretty good, no problem. There are some orthodox views. Don't fight with them. Those who have an orthodox view with regard to these things may have them. Let us respect them for they're, we'll not call them foolish or this or that. Let them have their orthodox view. But in this world, many gurus, many saints, many teachers have permitted repeating Veda mantras like Gayatri mantra without all those formalities. So answer is we can.
Swami Ramanujam.
Yes, Ramanujam.
This prajna which we have talked about in this one hour
yeah.
is The same as the prajna which is talked about in Haitiriya Upanishad, where we say that sarvam tad prajna netram, prajnane pratishtitam, prajna netre lokaha, prajna pratishtita, prajnanam brahma.
Yeah, Haitiriya Upanishad, the Mahavakya prajnanam brahma. I would say when Vidura uses the word prajna, he primarily uses it as an intelligence that applies to various, you know, puzzling situations,
material situations,
right and wrong and so on. And Aitreya Upanishad, when he uses the word prajnanam, is not contrary to what Vidura is saying, but I would say the attention goes to the culmination of that intelligence. When you and I have this intelligence, it can rise to higher and higher levels. At the highest level, we see that we are not this personality. That is
more than the material level.
Hmm?
The spiritual level more than the material level.
Correct. Correct. Because otherwise, prajna is operating on dharma-adharma level. Now, on higher level, it starts operating on anatma and atma.
Okay.
A while ago, you were using this intelligence to decide what is dharma, do it, and what is adharma, let go of it. And that, as you get equipped with more vairagya, more mumukshutva, your life changes. And the problems you are facing are no more issue of right and wrong. You are grappling with the question, who am I? And then you get the intelligence. The intelligence makes you see that I am pure awareness. Full stop. You know. So the Aitreya Shruti, Prajnanam Brahma, etc., is the culmination of the general treatment of the subject prajna. And I thought you were going to ask about Gita Stita Prajna. There also it is the same understanding. Spiritual truths on the highest level, Atma Jnana, on a couple of notches below, clear knowledge of Dharma Adharma. Siddha Prajna doesn't fall from right assessment. Yeah.
In the Vijnana of the Vijnanamaya Kosha in Taittiriya Upanishad?
Vijnanamaya Kosha is what hosts, what houses Buddhi. And it is the Buddhi which is part of Vijnanamaya Atma, that can have intelligence or that can lack intelligence. Yeah. That is like the host computer which has a certain software.
Hari Om Swamiji.
Kumar Vasisht, please go on.
What sadhanas can we implement day to day to increase intelligence?
Yes, yes, yes.
To be more clarity.
Correct. Yeah. I am of the view that all of us need to have an integrated approach. That is, integrate means take several things, put them together in right proportion. The proportion every one of us has to find out by experimenting. Some of us may need, let's say, in a random way of telling some figures. Some of us may need 1.5 hours of asana pranayama, physical exercise, half an hour of study, and 15 minutes of meditation. Some others may not need so much of physical exercise, etc. We are pretty free of lethargy. We are pretty free of laziness, etc. We are cheerful. Then we can reduce those yoga, asana, pranayama, etc., walking, etc., study more and meditate a little. Some of us may not require much study also. They are very clear. They can see that I don't have to study. I'm very clear about what to meditate on. Then they may increase the meditation duration. So either way, once you do some trial and error and find out the proportion, the integrated approach requires that we keep ourselves fit and energetic, as fit as our age permits, and study so that the inputs are available, because you can't meditate without a certain input. Even in Bhakti Marga, they need a picture of Rama, and they meditate on Rama. In Jnana Marga, a certain Upanishadic statement or Prakarana Grantha's paragraph helps us see, now I want to meditate on this. This is beautiful material to think of myself as the witness, as an example. There are many, many things. So make a combination of physically working on yourself and intellectually being up to date, being in touch with the subject, and then meditating. That means being in silence. If you don't do the third part, you will get so, you know, noisy in your mind. Just reading, talking and talking. Some of us do that. If somebody is a patient listener comes to us, we don't stop at all, go on and on. But that listener goes that way, we go to sleep. So to over-intellectualism is a problem with the Vedanta students at places. Yeah, someone else was, I guess, trying. Is it okay?
Guru Prasad.
Again, there's a question in chat box.
Rekha Ramani says, can we just disappear, meditate on pure awareness instead of a particular goal? Pure awareness is nothing but a particular goal taken to its limits. Goal becomes subtler and so pure awareness is this regular spiritual goal freed of boundaries, descriptions, color and taste. Awareness has no color, no taste, no height, no weight, no mass. Therefore, pure awareness is a particular goal, but taken to a certain very refined level. You may, if your question is, can we meditate on pure awareness? You can, you may, but only ensure that it doesn't remain simple word. You have a certain clarity. Yeah, being aware, being attentive. Was there another question in chat box that was not answered? Yeah, Katyayani asks, can you elaborate on thoughts on Brian Weiss' book with the Pura Janma? I would not elaborate in this webinar because this webinar did not go specifically to Pura Janma. I think it came in some other satsang. But all I can say is Brian Weiss' book, Many Lives, Many Masters, has provided a lot of examples of last century and generated good amount of acceptance towards this rebirth around the world.
Guru Prasad, Swamiji.
Yes, Guru Prasad, please.
Amongst all the strength, what we discussed, spiritual strength is more powerful than all. But why it is not listed under the other power? Why it is not listed under the bala, five balas, no?
We discussed this prajna bala includes spiritual intelligence.
Oh.
Yeah. So earlier also I raised it. Prajna bala, that is the strength of intelligence, could operate on dharma level for some of us. And the same thing operates on jnana, atma jnana level. Then that is distinctly spiritual. But it can operate on different levels. And all that has a place of its own. You know, for example, if, let's say, state or central government today in India suddenly finds out a way to supply lots of oxygen to all hospitals in next 3 days, will we not all appreciate it? It is an expression of intelligence. Oh my God, this is a good plan. They did this. Today, for example, a little video came that the Army, Air Force, Navy, they are swinging into action to supply oxygen to nook and corner of the country. The planes of Air Force, which are otherwise for war, right? The Air Force planes are carrying oxygen to corners of the country.
They are getting to Hyderabad. They are getting to Hyderabad hospital, Swamiji.
Oh, okay. Look at that.
A warlike situation.
So there is another question. Let me briefly answer. Lata Sonpal. In my humble opinion, Dhritarashtra did have intelligence. He just did not use his wisdom to make right decisions. There are people who are born intellectually challenged with low IQ, and we need to feel compassion for them when they do not have the capacity. Yeah, that's true. And this observation on your part also involves different definitions of intelligence, IQ, wisdom. So it will go into a little bit of linguistics. What we mean by wisdom, what we mean by intelligence, is IQ same as these two, or that's another? And so, but on the whole, I appreciate your comment. Thank you.
I have one more question, Swamiji.
Oh, yes, Sharada.
Can our human samishti prayer defeat the corona's power on the planet Earth? Because coronavirus is only just a small, tiny little virus, and human being is such a powerful human being. Can we all defeat with our prayer? Samishti prayer?
Well, I didn't hear the last sentence clearly.
The spread of this coronavirus. Can it be defeated by samishti prayer?
Yes.
By human beings.
Yes, but vast number of people don't believe in prayer. They are not praying. Even if you make an appeal to them, they will say, oh, okay, those who pray may please pray. I don't believe in it. So what do you do? In principle, yes. If large number of people sincerely pray, it will generate vibrations. But that is our wish. And most people will not, trust us, will not believe in it. For example, there are the communists who will say, look at this unscientific person. The people are dying, and even at such a time, this person is talking of prayer. Can there be anybody more unscientific than this? They will say. Because for them, going to temple is unscientific. Praying is unscientific. Conducting Homa or Havana is wasting ghee and rice and other things. They are, up in arms against various practices of regular religion. So we must know the earth is inhabited by a lot of people who do not have belief in these things. But in principle, if you want my answer, yes. I go with Maharshi Mahesh Yogi, who said if 2% of people meditate daily in a society, crime rate will come down.
Vibration,
health will improve, etc. One new message. Oh, what is that? It popped up saying one new message, but I'm unable to see. Maybe Hari Om. Someone wrote Hari Om, and that is also a new message for the software. Okay, so text messages, chat box we have handled. Anyone wants to vocally say something for as the last one, let us say?
Swamiji, this is Ashok.
Yes, Ashokji, I'm noticing, and I'm going to contact you after this webinar. Yeah,
right. No, I know you mentioned enhanced intelligence. So that of course includes wisdom, and with the spiritual practices, developing insight.
Correct.
So the insight is just part of that enhanced intelligence.
Yes. In the present context,
right.
There is beautiful insights. Spiritual insights.
Thank you.
Insights to change our domain, insights to let go of certain things, and put our foot forward in certain other things.
We have example of our doctor friends.
Uh-huh.
They are all intelligent people, but I've seen doctors with continued smoking, drinking, or overweight. They advise everybody else. So they know the effect of all those bad things. They have intelligence, but there is some misconnection between intelligence and insight there.
True.
Thank you.
All right. We'll meet again another time. Namaste, everyone. Hari Om.
Hari Om.